Hi guys, my name is Michelle and I create hair, makeup and lifestyle content here on YouTube. Today we're going to be talking about 5 myths surrounding curly hair. So if that sounds like something that interests you, then keep watching. So, myth number one, DIY hair treatments can replace store-bought products. We have often seen curly girls using handmade hair masks and conditioners. Some of them are rich in protein, some of them are rich in moisture. But can these hair treatments replace store-bought products that are formulated by cosmetic chemists and product formulators? The answer is no. The optimum size for follicular penetration ranges between 400 to 700 nm with a molecular weight of below 5000 mW. Each size is capable of selectively targeting different structures within the hair follicle. In the case of raw oils, the lipid molecules must have less than 18 to 20 carbon atoms to enable follicular penetration. So, I was talking to my friend Aditya Bose, and he's worked in cosmetic labs with product formulators. He's been in charge of R&D. So yeah, he has been in charge of quality control at a cosmetic lab, and this information is coming directly from him. So yes, although we see a lot of DIY hair treatments, in fact, you've also seen that in my deep conditioning video, I've shown you some DIY recipes for hair masks. You also see them all over Instagram and YouTube, but in truth, the size of the molecules or the molecular weight of these raw ingredients are not small enough to actually penetrate into the follicle. It is not small enough to actually go into the hair cuticle and therefore could never replace store-bought products. So interestingly, I was watching a video by Mixed Makeup, and I think it was Susan Yara, who is an aesthetician, and she was reacting to Bella Thorne and Kendall Jenner's skincare routine on Harper's Bazaar, and she was talking about how DIY masks, although it might seem interesting, it might feel convenient, I mean, you can just pick up ingredients from your kitchen and then use it on your skin and your hair. What she said was, these will never penetrate the skin surface, and that made me think, is it the same for hair? So I did a little bit of digging, and I'm gonna leave a lot of articles that I found in the description. Please check them out, because I always encourage you guys to read. So yeah, technically guys, I was wrong, Instagram is wrong, whatever you've seen on YouTube is not 100% accurate, because although the idea of using natural products on your hair might seem very enticing, might seem very convenient, might seem very inexpensive, technically if you're using these products as a leave-in conditioner or a hair mask, it is probably not doing you any good, because technically the molecular weight and the molecule size is not small enough to penetrate the hair shaft. So yeah, that is the first hair myth that we're busting. Now, the second myth, that glycerin causes frizz. And guys, for this one, I have my notes right here, okay? I have to read, because although I'm very familiar with the topic, I want to be super duper careful with my words so that you know exactly what I'm saying, and then I'll explain it to you in simpler words in case you don't understand the jargon. We first need to ask ourselves, what is glycerin, right? And for that, you need to understand the subcategories of ingredients. So you have humectants, you have emollients, and you have occlusive ingredients. You also need to understand the difference between hydration and moisture. So, glycerin is a humectant, which means that it grabs on to water from the atmosphere and hydrates your skin or your hair. So, in the case of your hair, glycerin pulls water from the atmosphere, and in the case of your skin, glycerin pulls water from the deeper layers of your skin and brings it to the surface skin cells and plumps it up. It hydrates the stratum corneum. Now I'm talking about the skin. So the top layer of dead skin is called the stratum corneum. It is the dead layer of skin cells. So glycerin as a humectant in your skincare, what it does is it takes water and draws it out of the deeper layers and brings it to the surface cells and plumps it up. It hydrates the stratum corneum and helps in moisture retention, skin barrier function, and it also helps to smooth out wrinkles by space filling. In the same way, in the case of hair, glycerin will pull hydration from the atmosphere and it will help in moisture retention by space filling in the hair. Now, do you know what does exactly the same thing? Hyaluronic acid and honey. If you are a skincare junkie like me and binge watch skin content, you would know that hyaluronic acid has been the ingredient that has been so celebrated, so sought after 2018, 2019, 2020. We were all about the hyaluronic acid. We couldn't get enough of it. We wanted it in every single product. You had serums, you had moisturizers, you had gels popping up all over the place just for hyaluronic acid. And it is a humectant just like glycerin. Glycerin is a cheaper alternative to hyaluronic acid, but essentially it does the same thing. It is a humectant. Now, in the case of hair, humectants will hold on to the hydration in the hair shaft and it will give you that shine and that gloss, and it will prevent hair breakage and frizz. Glycerin has a molecular weight that is small enough to actually go in to the hair cuticle and also go in, right in and in between the skin cells. It can penetrate the hair shaft and it can penetrate your skin. However, any humectant without an occlusive ingredient is not worth using. And let me explain. If a humectant brings hydration, okay, so in the case of skin, it's bringing it from the deeper layers, and in the case of hair, it is pulling that hydration from the atmosphere, right? So if a humectant brings the hydration, we need an ingredient to trap and seal that hydration and prevent water loss. In the case of your skin, it is called transepidermal water loss. So hydration can be lost very easily if it is not paired up with an occlusive ingredient. And that is what will cause frizz in the case of hair. In the case of skin, it is going to cause transepidermal water loss. So now, what is an occlusive ingredient? An occlusive ingredient traps the moisture and does not let it go. So basically, if your glycerin is bringing that hydration to your hair, or in the case of your skin, if it is bringing the hydration from the deeper layers of your skin to the surface cells, the occlusive ingredient that is paired up with the humectant is gonna say, hang on, stop. I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let that water or that hydration go anywhere. So we've spoken about a humectant and an occlusive, right? Now let's talk about hydration and moisture. Hydration is the absorption of moisture from the air and the infusing of your cells with that water to improve your hair or your skin's ability to absorb moisture and other nutrients and ingredients, which means that hydration that you bring to the surface of your hair or your skin is going to help better absorption of other ingredients that the humectant is paired up with. So a lot of the times in skincare, right, we see that products that have hyaluronic acid will be paired up with, let's say, vitamin E or vitamin C. You've seen it in the case of serums. So the humectant in your product is going to help better absorption of the other ingredients that are in your products. Whereas moisturization is about trapping and locking that hydration. So hydration is about attracting water to the surface, and moisturization is about trapping and locking that moisture that you've brought to the surface. So humectants are hydrating and moisturizers are sealing. Now, since we've spoken about hydration and moisture, and we've also spoken about humectants and occlusives, we also need to understand what an emollient is. So an emollient is just a lubricant, and of course it is smoothing. An emollient can also be sealing in nature, but essentially its main job is lubrication or smoothing. the surface, let's say of the hair, so smoothing the hair cuticle or smoothing the skin. So let's talk about glycerin, because all over Instagram we see that the moment it is winter, most curly girls will tell you stop using glycerin in your products. Now look, where does the problem occur? If you are taking raw glycerin straight up and applying it to your hair without any knowledge of product formulation, then a humectant not paired up with an occlusive or an emollient is definitely going to cause frizz. Why? Because like I explained, a humectant brings the moisture, right? So it brings the hydration right to the surface. But if you don't have an ingredient that traps the moisture, it is all of that moisture, all of that hydration is just going to get lost. And then your hair is going to spring up and it is going to cause frizz. But when we buy a product, a store-bought product that is formulated by a professional, trained product formulator in a cosmetic lab who knows exactly what they're doing, they are not going to give you glycerin straight up. They are obviously going to formulate the product in such a way that it has a humectant along with an emollient and definitely, of course, an occlusive ingredient. So unless you're buying glycerin, straight raw glycerin, and applying it to your hair, you shouldn't be worried about glycerin causing you frizz. A product is definitely not going to have glycerin as a standalone ingredient in it without including an emollient and an occlusive ingredient in the formulation. Remember that the people who are formulating your products have the expertise, have the knowledge. They are not going to give you something that does not work for you. Look, we on YouTube are not professionals, they are. So when you buy a store-bought product, you are paying for what you get. You are paying for a professional, an expert, a trained professional to formulate your products so that it does not cause you frizz. On the other hand, it is going to be a product that is formulated very, very well so that it helps your hair, it nourishes your hair, it reduces frizz and does not cause it. Myth number 3. Conditioner makes your hair fall. A lot of the times you will see people complaining that, hey, I used this product or this conditioner and it made my hair start falling. Now look, more often than not, the actual cause of hair fall when it comes to conditioners is when the conditioner is left on the scalp. Conditioners are generally very, very heavy. They contain oils, butters, sometimes waxes. So these ingredients have the ability to clog the skin on your scalp. And we all know that one of the causes of hair fall would be a clogged scalp. So if you're co-washing, be very, 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 very careful to rinse off that conditioner from your hair completely before you step out of the shower. Even if you're using normal conditioner as your co-wash, even if you're using a deep conditioning mask and the mask says that it's okay to put this on your scalp, make sure that you are thoroughly rinsing it off your scalp before leaving the shower. Even if you're using a leave-in conditioner or if you're using regular conditioner as a leave-in, do not apply it close to your scalp. Remember that your leave-in needs to be focused from your mid-length to your ends. Whatever you have left on your hands can go to the top, but always remember to go at least 1.5 inch. Where are my hands? At least 1.5 inch away from your scalp. Do not apply any conditioner to this area, okay? Because you definitely do not want to clog your scalp with that conditioner because it is a very heavy formulation. If you're a curly girl, then most probably your products are very heavily formulated. So, more often than not, it is not your conditioner that is causing you hair fall. It is more likely the way in which you're using your conditioner. So, your conditioners were not intended to go anywhere near the scalp, right? So, used in the right way, in the way in which it was intended, a conditioner cannot cause hair fall. But if you are not careful with your products and you're not using your conditioner in the right way, then that is what causes hair fall. Myth number 4. A certain product or ingredient can stop working for your hair all of a sudden. We often think that hair is made up of keratin, but this is not true. Hair is made up of dead cells filled up or surrounded by keratin. Hair is technically made up of cells that are no longer living. If something is dead, it does not have the ability to adapt, to mold, to change, to develop. And therefore, hair does not have the ability to become resistant to a particular ingredient. Your hair can't stop loving a product all of a sudden. That idea is fallacious. You can repair split ends. Again, hair is made up of dead cells and therefore it does not have the ability to repair and restore itself. You can definitely change the appearance of your hair by giving it nutrition in the form of protein and moisture. The appearance of hair can also be changed by maintaining a good, healthy, balanced diet. Products that are applied topically can also change the appearance of your hair. But remember that all of this will only change the appearance of your hair. Since the hair is dead cells, it is not technically capable of changing, molding, growing, adapting, or restoring itself. So these were 5 hair myths busted, and of course I'm going to leave a lot of links for you to read down in the description bar. Once again, I want to say thank you to Aditya Bose for providing me with the information on molecular weight and molecular size. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video and gained some value from it. If you did, don't forget to give me a like. Subscribe if you haven't already. Follow me on Instagram if you want to see more from me. Thank you so much for watching, guys. My name is Michelle and I will see you in the next one. Bye.